Thank you all for coming tonight. This is the first in a series of a few last lectures that we have this semester, and I'm really excited to be starting it off with this very special speaker. The last lecture series is part of FIRE, which is the first year residential experience. It's a series of programs specifically for first year students in Harborview Hall, helping them get acquainted with the Wagner community. But we're very lucky to have the last lecture series as part of this program because it really highlights, I think, what is truly special about our community and engaging not only students in the FIRE program, but bringing staff and administrators and faculty into that program as well. So I'll get right to the chase. I'm very pleased to have with us Dr. Lily McNair, our provost, and I want to give her a very warm welcome as the first speaker in our last lecture series. So, welcome.
Hi, everybody. Can you all hear me okay? If I need to use the microphone, wave your hand. Thank you so much for inviting me to give a last lecture. This is really an honor for me. I have long heard about the last lecture series at various colleges and universities, and I always thought it was a wonderful way to reach out and open up to students and really impart in an informal and very human way life lessons and to share oneself. So I'm really honored. Thank you so much for inviting me. I'm going to give a little caveat here. I'm prepared with my water and tissues because many of you know I'm the allergy girl on campus. And if I start coughing and so forth, you know, I'm not contagious. So I hope that this little cough drop is going to do wonders for me. I've been reflecting on my childhood dreams as I prepared my comments tonight because Randy Pausch's lecture was called The Last Lecture, Really Achieving Your Childhood Dreams. So I thought about how important dreams are, especially when we're children. You all had dreams, whether you're a faculty member here, staff member here, whether you're a first year student, sophomore, junior, or senior. You have had dreams when you were young, and you still have dreams now. When I think about my childhood years, I think about all the wonder I had about what my life would be like one day. What it would be like to leave my little hometown of Browns Mills, New Jersey, and go out into the world and go to college. And I know that for many of you, especially those of you who are first-year students, this is probably the beginning of a very important journey for you in achieving your dreams, I would imagine. Coming to Wagner College, living here on Grimes Hill, living here in Harborview Hall with your wonderful RD and your RAs, all the experiences that you've had in the first year program, the experiences you've had in Port Richmond or in your other learning communities are all part of you fulfilling your dreams. As I thought about the last lecture, all I could think of was, oh my goodness, am I going to say anything that really makes a difference? Or am I going to say something that really imparts something that I've learned and I've shared? I thought about all the implications. Oh my God, the last lecture, this sounds so formal, it sounds so final, it sounds so serious. Until I ran into Professor Walter Kalber this morning, and he said, you don't even have to know what he said, you all had a little chuckle, right? Because you know, Dr. Kalber said, I'm sorry, I can't come this evening, I'm teaching class, but shouldn't this be your first lecture? Because you just got here, and this is your first lecture. So I like to think of this as my first and last lecture. Okay, so I've been thinking about my childhood, my dreams, my professional career, and I've had a consistent theme related to relationships and the lessons that I've learned. And I'm not just saying that because I'm a psychologist. So I want to give you a brief sketch of my career right here, because I'm going to be drawing from my career as I impart and share some little experiences and some lessons. You know, I'm a psychologist. I'm a clinical psychologist. I went to Princeton University, which is about 40 minutes up the road from where I grew up. At Princeton, I majored in psychology. I started out as a chemistry major, though. I wanted to become a psychiatrist. And then as I learned more and more about what psychiatrists really did and what they didn't do, I realized I really wanted to connect with people more. I didn't want to focus primarily on prescribing drugs, working in hospital facilities. I really wanted to get to know people and work with people through therapy to help them achieve their goals and improve and so on. So I changed my major from chemistry my sophomore year to psychology. And I remember going to see one of my advisors my sophomore year, and I said, I want to go to grad school in clinical psychology, so I'm here to talk to you about what I need to do to get prepared. And he looked at me and he said, aren't you a little early? You're still a sophomore. And in my mind, you know, I was like just trying to get on with the program. But my professors were very, very supportive. I graduated from Princeton. I went to Stony Brook University in Long Island to get my doctorate in clinical psychology. After my fourth year there in the doctoral program, I went away on internship because the clinical psych program is between a 5 and 7 year doctoral program. And one of those years has to be spent doing an internship. So I went all the way to the West Coast to the University of Washington Medical School in Seattle, and I interned there for a year. After that, I came back to Stony Brook, got married, finished my dissertation, and then my first job was at SUNY New Paltz. I was there for a couple of years. Then I went across the Hudson River to Vassar College. Then I came back across the river to New Paltz for 2 more years. And by this time, I was pregnant with my second child. And then I left New Paltz when I got a phone call from one of my former Stony Brook graduate student colleagues who was at University of Georgia. She invited me down for an interview because there was a faculty position there. I went, I got the job, we moved to Georgia. I was at University of Georgia for 12 years. I rose from being an assistant professor to an associate professor. I got tenured. When I got tenured in 1999, believe it or not, you won't believe this, I was the first African-American woman to get tenured in the psychology department. Wow. You won't believe that. You can't believe that, can you? It's unbelievable. No, I don't mean like that. I mean, it's unbelievable that in 1999, there were no other African-American women who were ever tenured in that department. Prior to my arrival there, there was one other African-American man who was tenured in that department. So it was a very different environment there. But I did well. I survived. I liked it. I was planning to stay there and go on up for a promotion to full professor. Then I got another phone call to come and apply for a job at Spelman College. And I left and I went to Spelman. I got the job. I was associate provost of research and professor of psychology. I loved it. Was there for 7 years. And how did I get to Wagner? My mentor at Spelman, the president, President Beverly Daniel Tatum, told me about Wagner and said, there's an opening, you should apply. And here I am, a little over a year later. So that gives you I love it here, I'm thrilled to be here. But I share that thumbnail sketch with you because it gives you a sense of my career path. I never would have thought I would end up where I am right now. When I was in graduate school, I used to talk about my future with my husband. We weren't married then, we were in graduate school together at Stony Brook. We were both in the psychology department. And we talked about one day setting up a community mental health center, working in the community. We're doing a lot of that now, isn't it wonderful? Working in the community, connecting with the community, making the lives better of people in your community. But I never thought that I would be a professor, an academic. I never thought I would end up in administration. Probably because the life of academia just at a Research One university just seems so, what's the right word? Stressful. What was the word?
I said structured.
Structured and stressful and, you know, publish or perish. And when, among your graduate school cadre, so many people say, well, I don't know if I want to do that. I'd rather go work here. I'd rather go there. But I've been in academia all my life, and I'm thrilled, and I'm happy, but I never knew that's where I'd end up. So I guess that's a lesson that I didn't even put in my notes. Sometimes we have no idea where life will bring us, but we have to be open to those possibilities. So this is, so that's the thumbnail sketch of my journey. I said I was going to focus on the lessons I've learned about relationships. Relationships with others, relationships with yourself, understanding yourself, and your relationship with the world around us. So, the first story I'm going to tell is what Richard calls my Princeton story. And some of you have probably heard that. Who's heard my Princeton story? I know all the faculty have. A lot of the faculty who were at my talk at my interview have heard this story. So some of you haven't raised your hand. So good, I won't be boring you. I'll share. For those of you who've heard, I'll try to embellish it a little bit. So it's okay. But I'll stick to the truth. I'll stick to the truth. My Princeton story is very powerful. It's powerful for two reasons. One reason it's so powerful is because at the time when I voiced this childhood dream, I had no idea, A, that I would really achieve it, and B, that it would have been so instrumental in my life course. So this is the Princeton story. I grew up in New Jersey, a little town outside of major military installation. My father is an African-American man who was in the Army during the Korean War. My mother is a Japanese woman that he met when he left Korea and was stationed in Japan. They met, they got married, they came to the States. I grew up outside of Fort Dix because that was the last base where my father was stationed. One day when I was 8 years old, I remember being in the living room and I heard on the news that the Emperor of Japan's nephew, I believe, was graduating from Princeton University. I remember as if it were yesterday. And I said to my mother, "Oh, the emperor's son is graduating from Princeton. That's where I'm going to go to college." And my mother said, "Lily, girls don't go to Princeton." And at that time, Princeton was not co-ed. Princeton was an all-male Ivy League institution. And I said to her, as if I knew what I was talking about, "Well, when I grow up and it's time for me to go to college, they're going to let girls into Princeton and I'm going." Now, mind you, my parents are not people of means. Neither of my parents graduated from college, let alone an Ivy League university, so they probably thought, "What is this child talking about?" But that was my first dream. That was my first dream, and I ended up going to Princeton. How did that happen? It was just, I guess I was bullheaded about it. I was just had this focus. When it came time to apply to college and so forth, I didn't even apply to Harvard. You know, people were like, "Why aren't you applying to Harvard? Why aren't you applying to Yale?" I'm applying to Princeton, and I applied to safety schools. I applied to other schools who shall go unnamed. They're very good schools. Some were private, some were public. But I said, Princeton is the one I'm going to. And my father said to me, "Well, how are you going to pay for Princeton?" I said, "I'm going to get scholarships." And he said, "Well, why don't you just go to the community college like everybody else does? And then you can transfer to the state school." "Nope, I'm going to Princeton." Well, I went to Princeton. I went to Princeton, I got full scholarship. Well, not full scholarship, my parents paid $200 a year for me to go to Princeton. I was able to graduate with minimal loans, you know, like minuscule loans, this much. I had scholarships, and it was a dream come true. And it changed my life. I had no idea that going to Princeton would have such a major impact on my life. And in the vein of developing friendships that are lasting me a lifetime, my closest friends now are people that I met and grew up with in college. And I dare say many of you are having those experiences now, and those of you who are my age and younger probably have had some of those experiences too. But we know how important these years are, these college years. I was well prepared for graduate school and beyond. Being there, having that education prepared me for extemporaneous speaking. Writing, I had the confidence from doing the research. Everybody had to do independent research. I remember being a junior or a senior and being an RA and being called at the last minute by the assistant dean to go speak in Alexander Hall to students about the pros and cons of living in my residence hall. And if you've ever been to Princeton and you know Alexander Hall is where concerts are held. So it's a huge concert hall. And I remember what I wore that day. I was standing up on stage, lights were on me, and I was talking about life as a student in the residence hall, being part of that college community. I remember thinking, can't see anybody in the audience, so I'm not going to be nervous or scared. Mm-hmm. But that experience and those skills have really been instrumental in helping me to be able to stand in front of people and talk, even though I may look nervous right now, even though I may have said to Lee, oh boy, it's going to be. But, you know, it's important to be able to connect with others. So the professors, my major professor there is still somebody with whom I stay in touch. And it was my major professor there and the kind of influence he had on me that helped me to decide to go to Stony Brook for graduate school, which was really important, not only because of the excellent education I received, but because I met my future husband there. That was, you know, who would have known? So relationships were always very important. Once I had that idea and went to college, went to the school that I want, that was my dream school, the relationships I've had with people there were what sustained me and kept me going. It wasn't easy being a black woman at Princeton when I arrived in 1975. The first women to graduate from Princeton graduated in 1973. I didn't realize it at the time, but I was really part of a group of trailblazing women and trailblazing African American women who went to Princeton University. I didn't see my experience there as being one of being, oh, we're minorities and we're marginalized at this all-white, predominantly male bastion of Ivy League education. I just went in there and I just wrapped my arms around it and made the best of it with my friends. And at that time, the entering class may have been about 400 or 500, and I would say in my entering class, there were probably about 30 or 40 African-American students. So there was a good community of support of students of color, and at the same time, I had friends across the board. So just an amazing, wonderful experience. But part of a lesson, an important lesson, is relationships are so important. Second lesson, when opportunities present themselves, be prepared. My mentor has said to me, in her own way, in her own charismatic way, when the phone rings, pick up the phone and answer it. You never know what opportunity is waiting for you. When I applied for this position at Wagner, I was at a point in my life where I was structuring everything in my life, and I almost didn't apply. Why? Because I said to myself and I said to my husband, I'm going to stay at Spelman one more year, and then I'll apply for another job. Why did I want to stay at Spelman one more year? Because my daughter would be graduating at the end of that year. And if it's for some reason, I imagined myself being on the stage with her when she got her diploma. And I tell you, I was kind of like dogged about that. I'm not even looking for a job, even though my mentor said, it's going to be time for you to explore other opportunities, Lily. It's time for you to grow. It's time for you to learn. It might be time for you to leave Spelman. It's like, nope, I don't want to leave. I want to be here until Marguerite graduates. One day my husband said to me after he checked out the Wagner website and so on, he goes, Wagner is an excellent place. I really think you should give it a chance. I really think you'd like it there. I think it's the kind of place where you could grow and flourish. And Lily, really, do you really want to not apply just because Marguerite is going to graduate in a year? I think it's okay to let that one go. And I listened to him, and I'm glad I did. But I wasn't prepared for the opportunity. It's important to be open to opportunities. It's important to be flexible and see the possibilities in yourself. For each job I've gotten since I've been at New Paltz, where I started my career, for each job, the transition was made because somebody picked up the phone and called me. When I left New Paltz for UGA, it was because one of my grad school friends, who was then a professor at UGA, picked up the phone and called me. When I left UGA to go to Spelman, it's because somebody said, come and apply for this job. And the same for Wagner. So we never know what life has waiting for us, but we have to be open to possibilities. In many ways, these possibilities came out of the blue. But the thing about responding to opportunities that come unannounced and unforeseen is that you have to always be prepared to be at the top of your game. You can't be unprepared and say, okay, I'll follow through on this one. You've got to always be ready. You've got to always be prepared. You have to always be prepared as if you would have to put your best foot forward tomorrow. What does that mean realistically? It doesn't just mean make sure your vita or your resume is always ready. It really means that the reason why these opportunities will come to you out of the blue is because you present yourself in a way in which you show that you are prepared, you're open, you're willing to roll up your sleeves and try something different. It's not good to go through life like this on a path, on a mission. That's good in and of itself, but when you go through life with blinders on a path, on a mission, and you're not open to other new experiences, and you're not prepared to take on new experiences, you're gonna what? Miss out on new experiences. So here I'm talking about a relationship with yourself. Expect the best of yourself. Hold yourself accountable to high standards. It's kind of like if I came to work here every day, dressed in my jeans, although my daughter's glad that I'm not wearing what she calls, quote unquote, mom jeans. Mm-hmm. But I came dressed in my jeans and my boots and my little sweater, and I just kind of bopped around. You probably look at me and go, she doesn't act like she's a provost. Is she really the provost? Does she really know what she's doing? I might have to wow you a lot in that garb before you really see me as who I am. So I'm not just talking about how you appear physically, but I'm also talking about how you carry yourself, how you project yourself, how you feel about yourself, what your expectations are about yourself, because people relate to that. You think it's invisible, but it's very, very powerful, and it speaks volumes regarding how people see you for who you really are. And that, of course, is associated with the opportunities that come to you. And I don't mean walk around as though everybody's looking at you, as though everybody's checking you out and trying to think about what's next for you. Just be comfortable with who you are and be comfortable and acknowledge and accept the fact that how you project yourself is very evident to the world around you. And decisions are going to be made about you, and there are going to be consequences based on how you project yourself. Okay. So, when you are in relation with people, you know, we're talking about relationships and how you project yourself, your relationship with yourself. Another valuable lesson I've experienced throughout every career is how important it is to connect to other people. And I don't mean that in a superficial way. I mean that in the most meaningful way. When you ask somebody, how are you, do you really listen when they answer? And if they answer in a way that says something's wrong, do you follow up and say, what's really going on? Or is it one of those, you know, cursory? So we all do a lot of the cursory, hi, how are you? But sometimes it's really important to stop and really listen to people. Do people get the sense that when you're listening, you're genuine, and you're actively listening, you're focusing on them, you're not just listening for what you want to hear, you're not just hearing the words and then thinking about what you're going to say next? How do you really interact with other people? What do you like on a team? What do you like in a group setting? Many of you have been in learning communities, you've gone out in groups to the civic engagement opportunities. How do you connect with other people? Your peers, with your colleagues, with the residents and the children in Port Richmond, how do you connect with them? Do you get involved and then when there's a success, you want to take credit for the success? Do you want to be the center of attention? Or are you there because you're part of a team, you've got a goal, you want the goal to be achieved, and it doesn't matter who gets the credit, it's just important that the work gets done? Think about how you are in those situations. I can tell you, one of the things I've seen over the years is that having a sense of arrogance and entitlement will keep someone from succeeding more than almost anything. Being arrogant, having a sense of entitlement, is the antithesis of being compassionate, having empathy, truly understanding other people and being humble and having a sense of humility. It's difficult to work with someone who behaves in an arrogant way. Notice I didn't say it's difficult to work with an arrogant person. I'm talking about the behavior, right? It's difficult to work with people when they behave in an arrogant or entitled way, when they behave in a way that's not collaborative, when they behave in a way where they want to gain all the credit. It's difficult to partner with people in this way. So I share that with you because I think in a competitive environment, and goodness knows the work environment outside of Wagner is getting more and more competitive. Sometimes we think that the way to be successful is to show and behave in a way that, you know, I've got it all. Pick me. You know, the loud, I kind of call it the loud in your face kind of leadership. You'd be surprised to know how a very quiet and focused and intentional leadership style can be even more powerful and meaningful than an arrogant and loud one. Okay? Trust your instincts. Trust your instincts. Trust your gut. All too often, we do all of our research. There's nothing wrong with doing research. There's nothing wrong with checking out the background stats, looking at the pros and cons, making up your list of pros and cons, assessing this way, that way, the other way, looking at it, slicing it this way, slicing it the other way, going to bed, sleeping on it, going back to it, revising, starting all over again. There's nothing wrong with that, except if you continue to ignore your gut, your instinct, that thing in you that says to you, this is the way to go. You've got to listen to that, and you've got to know when it's real and when it's accurate and when it might be a fluke. How do you know how to try it out, how to figure that out, how to distinguish between the two? Try listening to your gut in some low-impact, low-risk situations. Don't start listening to your gut all of a sudden when you're not sure you should in a really high-risk situation. But be open to the idea that your gut is telling you something. This is all about your relationship with yourself. You've got to get to know yourself. You've got to get to know who you are, so you can really trust who you are on the inside. Okay. I've very much learned to rely on these kinds of instincts and gut reactions in my role as a clinical psychologist. And I continue to use these skills every day. Ever since I started working at Spelman when I became a full-time administrator. When I was at University of Georgia, I was a psychology professor, and in the clinical psychology program, I taught graduate students how to become clinical psychologists. I basically supervised their clinical work. We had a clinic there. Clients would come in. They would pay to see a student, graduate student therapist. We'd have one-way observational windows. I'd either be behind the window and observe the session, or I'd watch videotapes of the session. And literally, kind of, this is how you learn how to do therapy. You have a supervisor who watches what you do, much like student teaching. You know, learning by doing, right? So I was always in that mode of being a clinical psychologist. When I was in New York, I had a private practice. And when I was in Georgia, I didn't have a private practice, but I do have a license to practice in Georgia and New York. When I came to Spelman as an administrator, people would always say to me, "Don't you miss being a psychologist?" And I said, "No, I don't. I feel like I'm a psychologist every day." And by that, I do not mean I'm dealing with people's problems. By that, I mean I'm always using my skills of listening and observing and perceiving and listening to my gut. So for example, this evening when I walked in, Adams came up to me and introduced himself. And I said, "Hi, how are you? Blah, 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 blah." We talked a little bit. And then I said, "I saw you in the Hawks Nest this afternoon at lunch." He goes, "You did?" I mean, I said, "Don't worry, I'm not stalking you. But I'm just observant. I'm just observing, and that's part of the skill set, if you will, of a psychologist, to be observant. You walk in your therapy room, somebody sits down, you see the whole package. You don't just listen to what the person's saying. You look at their face. You look at how do they look like they've got a good night's sleep? Do they look like they've dressed? You know, when people are very depressed, you notice how they may seem a little more disheveled and so on. So looking at the whole person is important. Looking at behavior is important. I've always been very tuned into how people interact with each other. And that's just been a wonderful, wonderful skill that has helped so much when I'm in front of a class or in a class, working with my students in a class, just watching how people respond to each other and to me and to what's going on. It's just so critical. So these are instincts and these are skills, and they've taught me how important it is to pay attention to people. That's the bottom line. That's what I mean when I say I use these skills every day, you know, these skills I've learned as a psychologist. Because as a therapist, you're sitting there with a person or a couple or the family, and your undivided attention is on those people in the room with you. Everything else goes out the window. So you learn how to be incredibly focused and observant. And I tell you, that to me is something that has helped me to connect with people in just real meaningful ways. And sometimes people say to me, how did you notice that? I didn't know you noticed that. But it's as though you train yourself. You train yourself to notice and remember. People often say to me, how do you remember people's names? And I think it has something to do with, I don't know, but I wonder if it has something to do when you're sitting with somebody in a therapy room and you're listening and you're listening and you're listening and you're taking notes. You're so tuned in to every detail, and you've got to remember from this week to next week to next week to next week. Maybe it's a matter of how I train myself to remember and focus on those details. But what it does is it really allows people to feel incredibly listened to, and that's important. You know what it's like when you're talking to somebody and they seem like they don't care that you could be there or you could be a rabbit or a frog or something, you know? What difference does it make? But when you really listen to something, everything changes. So when I'm having a meeting with somebody and I might have to share some difficult news, I do so with great care. I do so with great care. Or if I'm in a hospital talking to a parent about their child who's just attempted suicide, I do so with great care. Because very often we have to talk with people about difficult things and communicate about difficult situations. But if you do it with great care and sensitivity and focus on the person and really, really convey that you're there about them, you'd be amazed at what happens. So I don't mean to say this only in the context of, think about this if you want to become a psychologist. Think about this if you're going into the helping profession. No, think about this if you're going to interact with another human being ever again, because it can really make a difference. Those of you who are RAs and RDs, and you've had all of this training around active listening and empathy and so on, I think you would kind of you feel reinforced by what I'm saying. Okay. Relatedly, dealing with issues that are important and difficult is very important. Whether I'm talking about dealing with issues with your relationship with a loved one, with your family, with a professor, with someone at work, with someone in a community setting. A lesson I've learned over my life is that when you ignore the difficult issues, they always come back and get you. They may change form a little bit, they may go away and metamorph or hibernate and come back as a different animal or creature, but it's always going to come back. People value direct, honest feedback. There's just no two ways about it. As a therapist, I've had some very difficult experiences with clients who've been severely depressed. And sometimes people don't come straight out and say, I'm really depressed and I'm thinking of killing myself. I'm really, really depressed. Sometimes they don't say that. When I was a new therapist, I remember the initial hesitation I had the first time I worked with somebody whom I thought might be suicidal. I kept saying to myself, you've got to ask them, you've got to ask them, you've got to just come out and ask them. My supervisor told me, my professor told me, you're not going to make them suicidal by asking if they're suicidal. And that's true. That's true. Very often we're scared to ask the tough questions because we're worried we're going to put an idea into somebody's head and they're going to do something because we asked. Don't worry, we're not that powerful. We really can't make people do whatever we want. So very often what I found, people who are really suicidal and aren't coming out and telling you, they are relieved when you ask the question because you've just lifted the burden of their having to figure out how to tell you, guess what, things are really bad. Things are 100 times worse than you thought. You've shown them that you've picked up on the cues. So whether you're talking to someone whom you're worried is might hurt themselves or somebody else, but oftentimes when you're feeling that I don't want to bring this up, I don't want to bring this up, sometimes that's just the sign that you need to bring it up. I'll give you another example. When I was a professor, I could tell that one of my graduate students who was in a doctoral program was not really into it. Their performance was sliding. They seemed very ambivalent about being there. They weren't doing very well with clients. And you know, we're talking about if you are in the therapy room and you're somebody's client, it's important for you to behave in a way that's going to help this person. So one day I had a talk with this student. And it was a tough talk. It's a tough talk. But I knew I had to do it. You know, when you know something's tough, that's the sign. You got to go in and do it. And I raised the possibility. I just said what I observed. I said, I've been noticing this. It seems like you might not really, it seems like you're not really into it as you used to be. I've noticed this. I've noted that. You don't seem as happy about being here. What's going on? And there was this sigh of relief. And the person said, you know, I've been struggling about whether I should really be here. I feel like there's a lot of pressure for me to stay. I don't want to disappoint anybody, blah, 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 and so on and so forth. Very, very clear, very, very meaningful. The person decided to take a leave, took a semester off or a year, did some soul searching and exploring, figured out that they wanted to be back, came back and was just a stellar student, graduated and is just doing fabulously, but said to me, if you hadn't asked me, I don't know if I would have told anybody because I was worried what people would think if I told them I was ambivalent. Again, this person wasn't able to really connect with him or herself about what was really going on because of the pressure, the perception of I might be seen as weak for taking some time off or deciding to leave. So often, as we become more and more compassionate and sensitive to others, we have to take the bold step. We have to let go of the fear and take the bold step. If you're really going to care about somebody and ask the hard question and address the issues that are really meaningful. And so, of course, this is related to making tough decisions and the right decisions. When I was a professor at UGA, one of the courses that I taught was ethics for clinical psychologists. And boy, there were some thorn, you know, we had a textbook this big, and we talk about our own experiences and those ethical quandaries that come up in those gray areas around boundaries and the blurred boundaries between therapist and client, professional relationship, personal relationship. Because when you're in the helping profession, whether you're a physician, therapist or a social worker, you've got to really take an oath to behave in an ethical manner and do only good for your clients. So ethics are extremely important, and that's something I've learned over the years. Sticking to principles around integrity and ethics, behaving in a professional and ethical manner is important. You've got to behave when you're by yourself and no one else is looking as though you would if the world were looking. That's the bottom line. That is the bottom line with regard to how you carry yourself in the world and how you behave in an ethical manner. We used to always talk about, in psychology, the appearance of impropriety is as damaging as an actual impropriety. If it looks like it's not right, that's as bad as if it isn't right. So therapists and clients are not supposed to have dual relationships, meaning that you can be somebody's therapist, but you can't be their friend. You can be somebody's therapist, but you can't be their brother. You can be somebody's therapist, but you can't be their professor. So the appearance of having a dual relationship is just as bad as if you were to actually have a dual relationship. So that type of perspective has consistently guided the way I behave. It's got to pass the smell test. If it smells funny, it probably is rotten. It's probably gone bad. If it looks like there's an impropriety, you can't continue to allow things to look like they're wrong. That is the bottom line. And this is significant and important in your relationships with your friends, your families, your faculty, your community partners, your supervisor. Ad infinitum. It's just a bottom line. So, I'm getting to the point of winding down. Looking at my watch, it's about time to wind down. I want to end with a perspective, a worldview, if you will, that's been very important in my life. Up to this point, I've talked primarily drawing from my experiences over my career, about transitions in my career, experiences that I've had, relationships that have been meaningful and have helped me to make important decisions and helped me to behave in a way that I feel has led to career moves and to my feeling of satisfaction and fulfillment in my life professionally. I want to, and again, as I said, these life lessons in this last lesson are very much related to relationships. Relationships with others, relationships to myself. Now I want to talk a little bit about an important lesson I've learned and share it with you about my relationship with the world and how that's impacted my relationships with others. And I'm going to draw from a Japanese perspective and way of looking at the world called wabi-sabi. Not wasabi. Mm-hmm. We know what wasabi is, right? This is wabi-sabi. W-A-B-I-S-A-B-I. Wabi-sabi. Wabi-sabi refers to a Japanese perspective on beauty or aesthetics values that honors and values the imperfect, the impermanent, and the incomplete. So it basically says it's important for us to value things that are imperfect, because nothing is perfect, and no one is perfect. Things that are impermanent, nothing lasts forever, right? Things are transient. We have to accept that. You can't hold on to this and love this and hope it's going to last forever in its same form and it's never going to break down. Things are impermanent. People are impermanent. And incomplete. The imperfect, the impermanent, and incomplete. Nothing is ever fully finished. Nothing is ever totally done. So in essence, this principle transcends ideas about beauty to really have implications for the way one looks at the world and perspectives on the world and people. Some have called wabi-sabi the valuing of wisdom and natural simplicity. In Japanese art, you see wabi very much in an ikebana flower arrangement. This is where I wish I had brought a PowerPoint of an ikebana flower arrangement. And an ikebana flower arrangement is a very minimalist arrangement of one or two or three blooms or branches or leaves, as opposed to a bouquet, for example, of two dozen red roses perfectly arranged in a crystal vase. The wabi perspective holds that this ikebana arrangement is simple, it's rustic, it's incomplete, it's not perfect, and it's in its own understated way, is elegant. So a fallen leaf floating down the stream. There are many, many examples in nature that really reflect this perspective on beauty. Okay? A tree branch falling across the snow. Okay? It's imperfect, it's impermanent, it's incomplete. The tree branch is broken, it's impermanent, it's eventually going to rot away, the snow is going to melt, and it's incomplete. You're still in the process of becoming. Okay? Sabi refers to beauty and the serenity that comes with age. So beauty is not, isn't that wonderful? I love that. I love it. Beauty is not only reflected in the ideals of youth and strength and perfection and ability, as in Western ideals of aesthetic beauty, but beauty is reflected in the patina or the fadedness of an old ceramic bowl that's worn away. It's got irregular shapes. It's been in your family for forever. There's lots of memories. It just carries that beauty. It just speaks life. It's not perfect, though. It's not a perfect porcelain cup that's gilt and finely edged with delicate scrolls. Now again, I'm not proposing and I'm not suggesting any differential valuation of different forms of beauty. I'm just pointing out differences in perspective. Okay? So you've got this rough and worn bowl that you can put your hand around and really feel it and connect with it. I've always felt much more comfortable drinking out of a bowl like this than a really, you know, fine bone china or crystal one. Okay? But just a different perspective, a valuing of the beauty that comes with age. So, wabi-sabi. In many ways, in our culture, we value material things and material objects. From a wabi-sabi perspective, and this has always been real important to me, the most simple of objects are valued and treasured and honored. Things that are imperfect, impermanent, and often incomplete. Now, I'm going to make an allusion to Main Hall here, okay? Main Hall is imperfect, impermanent, and often incomplete, and I know that there remains much work to be done. And when the Main Hall restoration is complete, there will still be aspects of Main Hall that are imperfect, impermanent, and incomplete. So I say this to point out that this perspective is not one of accepting less than. Rather, it's a valuation and honoring of the reality of life. And for me, it has really led to significance in the way I relate to the world, how I relate to the world around me, the people around me, and really engage my senses. Because senses are triggered through attention to these types of experiences. Part of what that means is that I feel very liberated and freed from these constant expectations of acquiring more and more things in my life. It was so interesting. If Anne Schotter were here tonight, she would nod her head in agreement. Many of you know that I've just moved here to Staten Island 7 months ago, and my house has furniture and stuff, but the walls are very bare. I believe in finding the right thing before I put it up. I don't believe in just filling up space or walls. I don't like a lot of clutter. So it's very, as Anne said, sparse and minimalist. And that's it's very much in concert with a wabi-sabi approach. Don't just collect stuff to collect stuff. Focus on what's really meaningful and necessary. If the thing works, even though it's 20 years old, and you like it, keep it. Don't just trade it in for the newer model, because we value the sabi part, the beauty that comes from age. Okay? So think about what it might feel like to accept the imperfect, the impermanent, and the incomplete. When you do that, when I do that, the stress kind of goes away. It gives me this breath of relief to say, okay, this is where we are. And now it can go forward. I don't have to change it right now. I'm not going to change it right now. I'm not going to complete this right now. It allows me to turn off the light, shut the door, and go home and come back to it the next day. So what I'm suggesting is that this approach to the world, wabi-sabi, has been central for me in providing peace, feeling connected to the world around me, accepting the world as it is. Not everything about the world, but allow me to accept what I can't change so that I can really gain the strength and the energy to put the effort into changing what I can change. Without feeling a sense of being tethered to material objects and materialistic values. So I share with you this last lesson for this last lecture. Think about and accept others' imperfections. Accept your own imperfections. You're still growing and learning. Remember, we're talking about the imperfect, the incomplete, and what's the last one? Oh my goodness. Imperfect, incomplete, impermanent, and impermanent. Right, because that was incomplete. Accept it. It's going to happen. Accept your own imperfections because you're still growing and learning. None of us is complete yet. None of us will be here forever. We're all imperfect, impermanent, and incomplete. And accepting and valuing this about our world, about others, about ourselves, we might be able to find the kind of inner peace, resolve, and strength that we need to connect with others in a meaningful way and to truly make a difference in the world. So, you deserve to achieve your dreams, and you can accomplish all you set out to do. I know you're here to continue that journey. I think a key, an important key, is to be honest with yourself. This is the time to be honest with yourself while you're here in this safe, protected haven of Wagner College. Accept your strengths and weaknesses, because we all have them. And to remember that none of us is perfect. We won't be here forever in this form. So let's make our time here mean even more. Let's make our time here more meaningful. Because we're incomplete, it tells us this is a great opportunity to continue to grow and stretch. So remember, nothing's perfect, nothing lasts, and nothing is finished. Wabi sabi. Are you supposed to have questions? Do you have questions? Yes.
What led you to your major?
My RA, Connie Chan, who's a psychology professor at UMass Boston, I had a talk with her my freshman year, and I said, gee, I'm not really sure I want to do this chemistry thing and go to med school because I really want to help people, and I like people, and I want to talk to people, but I don't know what to do because psychiatrists are the ones who do therapy with people, right? And she says, well, you know, Lily, I'm a psychology major, and I'm going to be a clinical psychologist, and you can do that too. And that opened up my eyes. So about 6 months later, I changed my major from chemistry to psychology because I had no idea there was such a field that could offer me the kind of training and experience that I wanted. Again, a chance relationship. Just chance that I had an RA who was a clinical psychologist. Yes.
Yeah, really learn criteria, and he emphasized 2 points, and one is it's very important to have high ethical standard. Mm-hmm. But on the other hand, he said, well, probably we should have what we saw the view of the world. Mm-hmm. Do you see any tension between these two things? So.
Yeah, no, because when you have high ethical standards, you will see that there are imperfections in the world, and there may be areas where you need to really enforce a level of integrity. You can accept the fact that there are some areas of weakness and at the same time do what you can to address that. So I see them going, you know, together hand in hand. Accepting imperfection doesn't mean that you accept it and you don't do anything about it. You accept it and acknowledge that it's there. You can choose to not do anything about it, or you can choose to address the imperfection. The key is to not fall apart because there are imperfections in the world. The key is to not fall apart because you feel that there's something that's gone wrong and you worry that you can't do anything about it. So I see them two being very much connected, and having that strong ethical compass can really help you to deal with the imperfections in the world. Does that make sense?
It made a lot of sense.
Okay. Oh, yes. Mm-hmm.
What advice would you give a student who is planning on attending school for 8 years plus and how they should stay focused?
Planning on staying in school for eight years? Get a lot of social support. I'm serious. My friends in grad school, we got through grad school because of each other. We helped each other to persevere. And many of my professors have told me, and then when I went to University of Georgia, and I was one of those professors teaching students in these long graduate programs, we saw that the difference between the students who succeeded versus those who didn't was a level of perseverance. It's not how high your GRE scores or how good your grades were or how great your research was. How much were you willing to stick to it? And what helps us to stick to it during hard times? The social support we get from others. Being able to sit down and let your hair down with others and say, I'm really having a hard time and I don't feel like studying for prelims, but I know I have to. And a friend who's a true friend says, we'll do this together. I'll support you, you support me. So that kind of social support, I think, is critical. You can't do it. You can do it all by yourself, but it's a real lonely journey. But eventually you see, 1 year gets down, and then two, then three. Next thing you know, you're finished. Yeah, like by the time you graduate from Wagner, you look back and go, wow, that went by so fast. Yeah. Okay. Any other questions or comments? Okay, well, thank you very much. I appreciated having this chance to talk with you.